all those streets. Now, just, you know, thinking of Robert Moses, the power broker, I'm looking at Adam, you know, Andy Cuomo, I mean, he's doing the airport. They just did the Kosciuszko Bridge. The Staten Zee Bridge is flying along. So I think this is fairly imminent, these train stations. Once that bridge is open, in my opinion, these train stations are going to come in because he's looking to run for higher office. So instead of hodgepodge developers coming in, doing a little piece here, a little piece there, I think it makes sense, since most of us are invested in this community, to actually work with city planning and do what we think is best for our community. So that's the little history behind it. So the motion is to send to the New York City Department of Planning an email requesting a rezone study of the following mixed-use area: Blondell area from Westchester to Eastchester Road, Sackett area from Bronxdale to Williamsbridge Road, Bassett Avenue from Morris Park to Dalton Parkway, and asking them to open, to look at opening up Bassett, because right now Crown Towing is renting that street. It's really, the street is mapped, but and we can open it up in city planning, or the city can open it up anytime. But since that would be another direct route into Pelham Parkway South, we were suggesting that, and Stillwell Avenue from Eastchester Road to Pelham Parkway South. That's a motion on the floor. Can I get a second?
Second by Al.
Is there any discussion? I think we can just call for a regular vote on this one. Just all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Those abstain?
Unanimous.
Motion passed. Thank you.
Okay, so going back to page one of the agenda, we have the nominating committee, which I'll turn over to Veronica.
According to Article 4, Section 3 of our bylaws, prior to each election, the chairperson of the board shall appoint a nominating committee consisting of not less than 3 and no more than 5 appointed members at least 8 weeks prior to the full board meeting at which elections are scheduled. Members of the committee are not eligible to be candidates for any elected position on the board. Tony appointed Joe Thurston, Sandra Unger, and me to the nominating committee last month. Joe, however, has since resigned from the board. Yehiel Mead has taken his place. Our bylaws further state, the recommendations of the nominating committee shall in no way limit the rights of a member to nominate himself, herself, or any other board member. When the committee recommends a candidate for a position, and if after the close of nominations there are no other qualified candidates, the committee may cast one vote for the nominee at the time of election, and by doing so, such person shall be elected to the position. The committee is not required to recommend candidates for all open positions, but it shall ensure the qualifications of all the candidates. All nominees must have at least 4 years of board membership to be eligible to be a candidate for any office or position. Nominations shall be presented this month only. Nominations may be made by any member and must be seconded to be valid. The nominees must be present to formally accept or deny the nomination. Officer positions up for the election this year are second vice chair, treasurer, and sergeant at arms. The nominations proposed by the committee at the April meeting were Joanne Rubino for second vice chair, Silvio Mazzella for treasurer, and Franco Segreda for sergeant at arms. Now, Silvio is not present, so he can't accept the nomination.
But he can accept
him
up.
Okay.
No.
I conferred about that. He's not going to be on the ballot. However, you can write him in. Right, David?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's what it is. I write him. You know, it's going to be a line.
But if he was nominated last month, and
He wasn't here. He had to leave early. Okay, and he's home still today, so.
Can I
We're just going to write him in, okay? All right.
That's not a bad idea, Sandy. Why don't we do something like this?
Can't do it by laws.
Can. Veronica, you want to finish?
The committee will now ask if there are any other nominations. Are there any other nominations for second vice chair? No. Are there any other nominations for treasurer? No. Are there any other nominations for sergeant at arms? Okay. At the June meeting, the committee will cast one vote for the aforementioned slate.
And with the exception of Salvio.
Yes, Fazovio, and you just write him in on the ballot.
Thank you, Veronica. We will turn it over to Dominic Shiano, Economic Development. Mm-hmm. I'm going to group this into two sections. The Economic Development Committee would like to send the SLA a letter of no objection for Enzo's renewal of Enzo's Restaurant, La Casa del Cafe, TGIF, and Nueva Imperial Restaurant. Second.
Second by Veronica Reyes.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? They all carry. Second section. Committee would like to send a letter of objection to Primo's Restaurant, basically for the reasons I stated before. Anybody second it? Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Abstention with cause.
So Veronica, abstention with cause. Brian, abstention. Edith Blitzer, abstention. Andrew Siegel, abstention. Joe Thompson, abstention. Janice Walker, abstention. And Junior Campbell, abstention. Jen. Okay. So the motion carries. The motion's still carried. So go ahead.
Don, I know you stated the reason before, but just to clarify for everyone else, just in case they don't remember what the reasons were for that objection. I know that we voted, but I still would like to hear the explanation.
When we had everything during the committee meeting, it was attended by at least three or four officers, one of them being Lieutenant Hickman, and he basically verified the fact that at one point in time, one patient was overserved to a point where he walked catty corner across the street, asked to be served at another establishment, they refused, he shot and killed him. Another incident was there was just some guy laying down on the floor sleeping there for 2 hours, who was overserved, and when the police showed up, there was some kind of disruption. Another time when the precinct entered the establishment, a bunch of people locked themselves in the restroom until I think finally they were let out or came out, and they wound up being teenagers. There was at least 4 or 5 more incidents. I don't have them written down, but that was our reasoning at that point in time, and the precinct was heavily against it. That's it.
Great. Thank you, Dominic. Moving on to transportation. Daisy Rodriguez.
It's on now? Thank you. So we have 2 motions. The first is a motion to recommend approval of 5 street activity permit applications. As noted in the agenda, these include the summer kickoff on June 3rd, also the 5th annual back to school block party on August 26th, the fun day 5 on September 16th, the Paulding Avenue block party on July 22nd, and finally the Hyatt Avenue annual block party on July 15th. Can I get a second?
I'll
Open for discussion. Edith?
My question is, it says Fund Day 5. Who is Fund Day 5?
Brian's House.
Well, should the put down Brian's House so we know who exactly it is. I'd like to have a Fund Day 5, too.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a similar question. I'd like to know who the summer kid is from. Who any of these are from?
That's how they record the street activity permit office.
Excuse me?
That's how they are recorded with street activity permit office, mayor's office.
That doesn't help me, though.
I can put the details next time.
Well, which ones do you want?
Who is all
of them? In the minutes.
So let's pull out the minutes. Good point.
No. They get these minutes before the meeting. So they don't read them. No.
So if you had a packet, it starts with economic development. It's right after economic development. So it tells you Bronzewood Summer Kickoff is Haven Ura who applied for that.
Okay.
Nelson Gonzalez for River Avenue.
Okay.
Janine Gazzola. So you can see Bronx House is 916. I'm not sure who these other people are. I don't know if it's really stated. Yeah, I mean, the block parties tend to be somebody on the block, who lives on the block, right?
Well,
with the exception of Rock's House. And then I would say Hazel, that except for the block.
It's in the minutes that were published.
Which one?
The Transportation Committee.
So it's this packet. So the packet that starts with economic development. We go in the order of the agenda.
Right, okay. I don't have where it says name on any of these.
Yeah, hold on, right there. You got Transportation? Is that Transportation?
There's nothing here that shows me who it is.
On page 1 of 3 of the Transportation Committee meeting minutes, it's there. If you don't, I'll show you.
Somebody missed a page. Was that Andrew?
I will come over there.
Jeremy's coming over there.
Hello, maybe that's being confused with the ones that were distributed by Jeremy as well.
See him on the website.
Okay, this is it. Thank you. Are there any other questions?
Any other questions?
So some of these are personal block parties?
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
They're all repeats. You heard that?
Yes, thank you.
All repeats.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right. The second motion is to send the New York City Department of Transportation an email with no objection regarding the proposed safety improvements for Boston Road between Pelham Parkway North and Waring Avenue. Can I get a second?
Sorry, can I second my shadow?
Discussion?
Yeah, this is for traffic calming on Boston Post Road. where it meets White Plains Road, there's some recommendation by the Transportation Department that they're going to make changes, including crosswalks, so people cross properly and don't get hit by cars. Any other questions?
Yeah. And this is going to be done prior to the reconstruction?
That is what we were told, yes. It doesn't touch Pelham Parkway. It's right above Pelham Parkway.
You said it has Pelham Parkway north?
Yes, but at the tip neck.
Between Boston Road and Waring is where they're going to be doing the reconstruction.
What's going to happen is there's going to be a left turn that's going to be approved for cars, but instead, right now they cannot, they got to move one block down. Also part of the change is the bus stop is going to move forward, so the traffic that's being caused right now will be not eliminated, but at least alleviate some of the traffic. Those are some of the proposed changes. And yes, we did inquire about further work, I guess, and they said until all the project is finished on Pelham Parkway North, I cannot commit to anything else. Any other questions?
All in favor?
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
So one opposed? Andrea? Anyone else?
No, an abstention, excuse me.
Okay, sorry. Anybody opposed?
No.
So abstention for Andrea and Pat Charles? So two abstentions. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Daisy. As some of you may have heard earlier when Veronica was reading the script, Joe Thurston resigned from the board, and Daisy has taken over as the co-chair for Transportation Committee. Congratulations, Daisy. Linda White?
I have a question for Transportation Committee. We have a horrendous problem in the lower end of Morris Park Avenue, especially in the mornings between 6 a.m. and 9 a.m. and then again between 4 p.m. and 6 p.m. on Morris Park Avenue between, it starts really at 180th Street. We have traffic backed up all the way to at least Bronxdale Avenue every day, every morning, every evening. It's in the opposite direction, the uptown direction. There does not seem to be anything that's being done with the lights to stagger it, so you have traffic just standing. People can't cross the street. Traffic cannot come out of the Van Ness blocks, let alone turn in the blocks. And it has become to the point where it's unbearable for us who live down here. Can it be visited?
I guess it certainly could be discussed at our next meeting and therefore be brought to the attention of the Bronx Borough Department.
And just an addendum, for the people, most of the traffic, the people who use that area know that they can't use Morris Park in the morning or in the evening, so what happens is they tie up Van Ness Avenue. And the school buses in the morning can't get through to get to the kids, so the kids are running out to the streets to try and catch their buses. So it's a very bad situation.
I'd just like to add that a lot of this was brought up when we had discussing the White Plains Road corridor. What is currently being done is that they had relabeled the left-hand turn into Mead Street off of White Plains Road, then the left-hand turn going into the Con Edison. We are still asking for them to bring it back to the way it was, which they're saying that they can't, but we have brought it to the Public Advocate's Office to hopefully discuss further. It's on our list of things that Van Est has given to the Public Advocate's Office for issues. But this is what's causing major issues, what's happening on White Plains Road with that congestion into the Van Ness, into Morris Park, and nobody seems to understand that unless you live there. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Lizzie? Leadership Committee, Al D'Angelo.
Good evening. The Leadership Committee met. We went over the agenda for this evening, and we okayed the calendar for June. I would also, since I have the microphone, would like to mention there is a fundraising benefit at, I believe it's Maestros? Little Verona, I'm sorry. On May 31st, in case you don't know the story, it's a heart-rending story. A young man gave a Sweet 16 party for his daughter, and he dances with his daughter to Daddy's Little Girl, gives a speech about his daughter, and has a heart attack and dies right in front of everyone. He had no insurance. He was 49 years of age.
Wow.
And they're having a fundraiser for the family. And I think he had three children, Tom? Four children, obviously 49 years old, they're young children. So they do have a fundraiser. The tickets are $100. I know maybe some of the organizations here can send a check. You know, I'm sure Tom will collect the checks for them if you can't make it.
There's an article as far as Bronx Times.
There'll be an article into Bronx Times tomorrow. So I think it's something that we should pull together for each other. And this is a family that, again, four kids, guy has a decent job, everything seems to be going well, and all of a sudden everything is taken away. And you have four children that we have to worry about. So, you know, they're members of our community, they're members of our family, and whatever we can do to help them, I think would be the right thing to do. We don't even need the appreciation, it's just the right thing to do. And the other note that I want to mention on Friday, Monday is Memorial Day, there are services at Peace Plaza and at Van Est. Peace Plaza, it's 11 o'clock, Van Est, it's 12. I think it would behoove everyone here to go. It's those who died serving this country. So I don't care if you're Republican, Democrat, liberal, or conservative. Families, loved ones, children suffered because someone died protecting our country. I think it's time to give them just that little services of maybe an hour in each place. So if you pick one or the other, yeah, ours is about 40 minutes, yours is about probably the same. We can't forget what went on before and what people did for us.
Mm-hmm.
It's very easy to get lazy and sit home and sit in a rocket to die. Mm-hmm. It's Williams Ridge Road, it's easy, it's Van Ness, it's easy. Or say a silent prayer if that's all you can do. But please don't forget those that have made this country what it is today and gave the last measure of their mm-hmm. of their existence. And, you know, the families suffer, children suffer. You know, there's a toll to be taken. Anybody who's lost someone in their family knows it doesn't just hurt the person who passes away. It's a rippling effect. It hurts all those that person touched. So we have two things to do. One, the fundraiser, and don't forget Memorial Day. Thank you.
Thank you, Al. Sal?
Yeah, going back to the fundraiser, my business is contributing. I want to make a motion that if we have funds in Friends of, that we donate $100 from our community board. It's setting the right example. Asking people to do it is one thing, doing it is better. I make a motion that we donate $100.
It was going to be a done deal before your motion. That's number one. I probably will probably do more than 100. I don't know exactly. It's going to be more than 100.
Anthony, thank you.
All right. So just remember, we're going to be at Calvary next month as well. That's on the calendar that's been distributed. Also, Land Use Committee members, there is a meeting on the 29th, scheduled for the 29th. Let's move to the Dr. Purcell. Community Development, the Prairie. Mike, please. Can you Dr. Purcell, Mike? Andreas, Zaya?
Jeremy, what day is the meeting next month?
For Land Use?
No.
22nd. The full board's the 22nd. 22nd. 29th.
Write it down.
Let's focus on the scene. So once again, the full board meeting is going to be here. All right? So, Dr. Patel.
The border spot railway station is coming up, and I'm thinking there needs to be a big impact on our board area. And in view of that, I would suggest that we should get some priority request budget items. Please think about it and keep submitting your request for budget priorities to the office. Thank you.
Great. Linda White, education.
Our minutes are enclosed. If there's any questions, please let me know. We did have a group that came before us. It's Pathways for Learning, which is proposing that they would like to open up a charter school in the area. We have more discussion to be done on it, so therefore that's why we're not coming before the board with a motion at this time. The other thing is the Yankee Awards. In discussion with the board officers, it has been decided that when we have our Yankee game, that'll be the time that we will give out the checks on the field for our winners. Our people that are men and women at that time. At the next meeting, we'll be letting you know what that's all about. Okay.
So, yeah, so I got an inquiry from a board member about Community Board 11 Day at Yankee Stadium. We were going to work on the allocations next week. We don't have the tickets yet. The game is June 20th. Tony?
I think, Linda, you said you're going to make the presentation to the checks on the field, correct? Okay. The checks, usually we do it here. We can't do it here, as you can see. We're going to do it on the field, okay?
Thank you. Health and Social Services, Joe Bacow.
Yes. Good evening. First, I'd like to thank the committee would like to thank the staff of Community Board 11 and also the members who attend their fair on May 6th, the health fair. We had 27 vendors who came to participate in that event. Even though the weather was inclement, we still had 27 vendors to come. However, we were sort of disappointed in the number of people who came to the event. But we hope next year to have it indoors. So we're working on that. And again, the staff at Community Board 11, I must say, we go out all the way for them. They really helped us to pull off that event, the number of people who participated in it. Again, I'd like to wish all of you a safe and happy Memorial Day weekend. And we look forward to have this event next year indoors. That's the Health Committee and Social Service.
Linda White?
You know, I always have to let you know what your company's doing. I'm sure everyone's read in the paper, if you read the chief or you've read some of the other papers, about the fact that there's going to be massive cuts at H&H, that's what they call it now. By June 1st, there's scheduled to be 400 to 600 people released from the 11 hospital system. Jacoby, we've been told, is 35. It's not being done as callously as it was before, that you come in and you suddenly get a call and say, please leave. I understand that they've been offered that they can retire if they're of retirement age or whatever, but either way, they will be laid off. They will not be there. So at this point in time, we're going to be losing quite a few people. This is management. So far, it has not hit the group 12, which is the average worker. We're waiting, the unions, we're waiting to hear if it's going to come down to that point. We're being told that we may be given a buyout. Not money, but time. We don't know. So as soon as I hear something, I'll let you know. But we're still having the same problems with nursing and the emergency room and everything we've been telling you about. It may get worse before it gets better.
Housing Gas Walkout?
The Housing Committee didn't meet last month. Just wish everyone a safe Memorial Day.
Arlene Drayton, Parks Department, Parks and Recreation.
Good evening, everyone. The Parks Committee did not meet last month because we didn't have any outstanding. Well, we did have some outstanding issues, but they're all pending. However, today I was invited to a meeting with the Bronx Borough Commissioner and the Commissioner of Parks, Commissioner Silver. What they discussed, it didn't have anything to do with Community Board 11, but Community Board 6 was there. They had some outstanding issues that were submitted into priority budgeting by Council Member Bruce Torres. So they addressed those issues with their parks. After those issues were discussed, I did bring up the top five that our committee had submitted, and those were Parkside Houses, Ben Abrams Park, Masai Park, and Brady Park. I submitted those into our priority budget request, and we did get some estimates back. Parkside Playground, the estimate to reconstruct the playground with new play equipment, safety surfacing, spray showers fencing, benches, sidewalk, and landscaping. That cost will be $3 million. The reconstruction of the basketball courts and handball courts, that will be $900,000. Reconstruction of the comfort station with ADA accessibility, $1.4 million. Now, there's a note here that says the cost reflects 6% annual escalation over 3 years. Ben Abrams Playground, same thing. All of the five parks are reconstruction of the playground, play equipment, safety surfacing, spray shower fencing, benches, and landscaping. However, in Ben Abrams Park, they are asking reconstruction of the playground for a tot-lot playground. I have to find out what a tot-lot is. I don't know if that's specifically for the younger children. This is something new that I've just seen in this report. The cost of that is $4 million. The comfort station reconstruction, $1.4 million. And all five of these parks have that same note on the bottom. Cost reflects 6% annual escalation over 3 years. Okay, Masai Playground. Total cost for the reconstruction, $3,135,000. Comfort station reconstruction, $1.6 million. And last but not least, no, not last, Bronx Park East. That's between Brady and Lydic Avenues. Total cost with this one, reconstruct sidewalk pavement and a cobblestone strips. That's what Edith had requested. Install new benches. The cobblestones cover an area of 4,500 square feet, and the sidewalk covers 5,000 square feet. That estimated cost is $170,000. So once again, Brady Playground was after that. Same thing, reconstruct the playground and comfort station. The cost, $4,450,000. The comfort station alone is $1.4 million. So at this point, we have to look into now funding. So those were the estimated costs, and what I discovered at this meeting I attended today, that's just the estimated cost by the Parks Department. Once they get the bidding and actually get a contractor, the contractor's estimate is more or less higher than what they've already estimated. So our next meeting will be Wednesday, June 7th at 7 p.m. at the board office. We're supposed to have a speaker from the design and construction team at the Parks Department, and they will be discussing the new exercise equipment on the Allerton Avenue side of Bronx Park East.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's my report.
Good. Thank you, Arlene. Public safety, Yahe.
Yes, we didn't even have a quorum. Okay.
Thank you. And once, like Daisy, congratulations on your appointment to co-chair. Sanitation Committee, Tony St. Valley here, Joanne Caroline.
Sanitation meeting was canceled, and happy holidays.
We went through all of that to say that.
Let's go to any old business. Edith Blitzer, old business, not new business, right?
I really don't know if this is old business or new business, but I had brought this up before in front of the board, so I'm assuming it's old business. And I'm going to direct this to Joey Manis, if you don't mind. There is a building that's up on Vines and Whitegate. It's been up for quite a while. Now we're getting concerned because it's not rented at all. It was supposed to be rented by January of 17. We've had words that the grapevine doesn't necessarily have to be true, that it could be made to a shelter. I am requesting that Community Board 11 investigate this so we know what is going on with that building.
That's the one across from the library.
Yes. It's right across the street from the new school.
Wow.
I did bring this to Mark Jonai. And the information we got about 6 months ago was that the building was not completed, which is not true. The building is completed, all the guards are on the windows, and nothing's happening.
Yeah, I mean, I've looked at somebody's request, I've looked into it too, and I looked at the application online. I mean, I can reach out to the Department of Homeland Services, but I don't want to give them any ideas.
Somebody has to know the owner of that building to approach the owner to see what he's doing.
Yeah, I mean, I can reach out to them, whether or not they... It's like Marilyn Soper's property, right?
Well, I have information on that in the GCS, but somebody do something to help us find...
Yeah, I mean, I'll make an attempt to reach out to the owner.
Appreciate it.
But, you know, all right. Joey, you want to say something?
Yeah, just, I don't... You know, with all due respect, I don't think that that's a land use issue. I think that's more or less a community board issue, and I think the way the route to go is find out what we should have, a record of all the buildings and services that's in Community Board 11, and if we're oversaturated, that's the way I think we can have a legitimate complaint, but without any information. I don't know how it would go about.
Okay, it's not that I have a complaint. I just don't like to see an empty vacant building and not knowing what's happening with the empty vacant building. I thought maybe I directed to you because you know the ins and outs of that.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to say. If the building is built as of right, the developer, owner, have anything to do with the community board, communicate with us, give us any information. So that's what I'm trying to say. It didn't come through. Every building does not come through the Land Use Committee, anything that's built. Only when they're trying to build something that's not allowed in the underlying zoning code. But we've had this issue before, over on Yates Avenue. I remember they wanted to put another home over there. Usually the agency comes and it has to be public hearing. That's my understanding.
All right. And as far as Marilyn Soper's property is concerned, I did hear from her daughter today, which is amazing. They are tearing down the stores that are vacant, but they have not decided what to put up there. So if anybody that's heard a building or a store, it's not so. They haven't gone into contract with anybody. They will let Joe Thompson know. We will keep with them.
Great. Okay. Any more old business? Joanne Trevino.
Okay, one word or two words. Barbecuing, what was it, four words on Pelham Parkway? It's a whole bunch of words. But that's, we have to remain vigilant, elected official representatives. and community board people and all of us. So if this is, you know, I think it's going to rain this weekend, but, you know, we still have to, you know, we may have a problem this weekend. So just want to remind everyone that that's still an issue. Thank you.
And when Romina late chatted to me about this meeting that Arlene was able to attend earlier, I did, you know, mentioned the barbecue and I mentioned, but also, of course, thank the council member's office because if it weren't for Councilmember Torres as well as Councilmember Baca, I don't think we would have seen the enforcement action that we've seen in recent years. So thank you once again. Someone else over there had another? Old business? Joe Thompson. Mike, please.
There's two things. Number one, due to a Jewish holiday next week, the council meeting is going to be pushed ahead, and it will take place June 6th, and it will still be at Bronx House. My second issue is I feel for Tommy and a lot of other people, and I'm sympathetic, but I think maybe the board should take a hand and perhaps even have a seminar and discuss and bring people together, let them know how important life insurance really is, especially if you have a family. And at 49 years old, that's relatively cheap for somebody that age. Buy term insurance, last 20 years, by then the kids are out of the house, and it's just you and your wife you have to worry about. But while kids are there, you have to be protected. Let's use some of those dollars and inform other people and use this as an example.
All right, great. Any other old or new business at this point? Verna?
Yes, thank you. I just, there was an email that went out today and that the Land Use Committee of Community Board 11, the Morris Park Community Association, and the Van Ness Neighborhood Alliance, we are co-sponsoring a town hall meeting regarding the New York City Board of Standards and Appeals application for 500-508 Van Ness Avenue. The developer of the property will give a 20-minute presentation followed by questions from the public. It's going to be held at where we usually have our full board meetings, on the Lou Ballin Hall at 1200 Van Ness Avenue at 7 p.m. on Thursday, June 15th. I urge everybody to come out because what's happening in Van Ness can happen in any neighborhood. And it is dealing with a developer who is trying to do something that's not zoned for it. And that last week we had our fourth meeting with him at Assemblyman Sepulveda's office discussing yet the same issues. So a town hall meeting is something that everybody's questions could be out there. And I do want to thank Joe McManus for being there for the meetings and helping us and being very supportive. So thank you.
Joe?
Just to give everybody an idea, if the project was built as of right, they'd have to build, I think, 9 apartments. Now the guy wants to build 47 apartments with 20 parking spots. So, I mean, even though we keep telling the developer we want to lower the building, now he wants to make the building flat, no side yards, no backyards, and still have the same amount of apartments, the same amount of parking. So the guy is not been cooperative. Both the Van Ness Community Association took a formal vote against the project. Matter of fact, Al D'Angelo from Morris Park made the motion at Morris Park against the project. So the two communities, at both times I went and I gave all the information. It wasn't like I said it was for it or against it, but the two communities voted against it. So we're bending over backwards, so we would appreciate everybody come. We'll have a sound system. Everybody will have a chance to answer. There'll be no, like, knocking anybody off. Everybody is going to get a chance to ask a question or make a short statement if they're for or against the project. Thank you.
Okay. And thank Thank you, Mary Ellen, for arranging for the meeting for that.
Pelham Park Remains Association is having their monthly last meeting for the summer on June 13th at Bronx House at 7:15. We have a special guest this month. We have Aurelia Green, the deputy borough president. She's going to be our guest speaker. Let us know what our borough president has in store for the Bronx. I'm sure big things. Secondly, the association's gotten a lot of complaints regarding the lighting, and not only by us, but all over the Bronx. I spoke to Navarro Lopez today, the new commissioner. He assured me that within 6 months, every lamppost is going to be replaced with LED lighting. So that's making it much better for us.
No.
Thank you. Sherelle?
Yeah, I have a concern. In March, there was a stormy weather where a tree fell down between Garfield's and Mid Street. It fell on my car and two other car.
Wow.
It's a very big tree, and we had to get the sanitation involved with Park also to get that tree cut and, you know, get it there. But the point is right now, the sidewalk is very high up, where the tree, the trunk, cut half and left one and left there. And I don't know who came there, but said that is the landlord responsibility to fix the sidewalk and cut the tree. And the person there is very old, about 8 years old, and she don't know what to do. So I'm actually coming to what can we do there to get that done, so that the tree can move and the sidewalk can be fixed.
Trees blocked.
Well, first of all, we can reach out to Parks, but I know another board member reached out to me about. The city policy in general, and I'm pretty sure I brought this up at my last district service cabinet meeting. You should definitely be in touch with your elected officials, primarily your city council member, in terms of because that's and I don't know if that's a policy or if that's actually being legislated, but if it's not, it could be legislated. I know it's not easy, but it's in terms of like maintaining these trees. Right? It's the city tree, but then they make the homeowner responsible. Well, call Parks. But you should also speak to your council member's office, too, if you have
The homeowner is responsible for the sidewalk.
Yes.
If it's a city tree, the city is not going to take care of that tree. They have to come and prune it, etc. I was once having my own trees pruned. I said, oh, I'll call them up and I'll have the city tree pruned. Oh no, you have to first get a permit from the city to have it done. So if you forget about it, you'll come and do it. And they didn't come for years.
So that's a good point. So for property damage too, maybe this person should speak to a lawyer as well.
If it's a city property, you can apply it only to the controller's office. And any city, if you wreck your tire in a city street or something happens from the city thing, the controller's office has some sort of process that you could make an application to them to get reimbursed for some of your expenses.
Yeah, there's a claim form. Right. Thank you. Bernadette?
No, I'm okay. No.
No? Anyone else? Okay, so Tony Vitaleo.
Okay, let's go back to page one of the agenda. Under the chairman's report, sub B, I make a motion to submit to the New York City Office of Management and Budget a merit increase for Jeremy Wanicki, Harriet
Lasky.
Harriet Hansky?
Lasky.
That's all I know by Harriet.
Is this going to be a closed session?
And Chris. Okay, I have the motion on the floor. Do I get a second? Janice Walcott. Wait a minute. Open for discussion. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
I oppose? Abstentions? Motion approved. Thank you very much. Stand by.
Meeting's not adjourned. That's not.
All right, listen, before you went out, please debate it for the record. Continue. The merit increases is as follows. A $2,000 increase to Jeremy Warnicki's salary beginning July 1 of 2017. Additionally, Jeremy will receive $1,660 raise retroactive to September 1st, 2016. And just get back to this. The reason why we're doing this, we have money that if we don't use it, we lose it. Okay. Let me finish that, then we'll get to you. The next one, add to $2,000 to Harriet Lansky's salary beginning July 1, 2017. Additionally, Harriet will receive a $1,540 raise retroactive to September 1, 2016. And finally, add $4,924 to Chris Kirkus' salary. Okay, $4,924 to Chris Kirkus' salary beginning July 1, 2017. Additionally, Chris will receive $4,103 raised retroactive to September 1st, 2016. Now, Joanne.
Well, if it's among the board or not just off the table without...
There's no discussion. There was no discussion. That's what I said. If there was a discussion, they would have been off the board.
But if this is all public way, Tony, and the board members want to go into executive session, and we should do that.
You want to go in? I mean, congratulations. Happy Memorial Day. I will be available for questions.